Greetings, it's Eric Bakker coming back again. Thanks for tuning in. We're doing a series on what we do and don't know about the gut microbiome, about the gut bacteria. Well, what we do know, there are plenty of published studies about antibiotics that say how bad they are. There are in fact hundreds of studies that show how bad they are. They're coming out more and more all the time. Some people never recover from antibiotics. You know, now, this could be two or three times they've had them, say, in a short period of time. So the more you have antibiotics in a shorter period of time, the higher the likelihood you're going to get a big problem. If we look at a journal published in the UK some years ago, I think it was a psychology journal, that showed that even one or two rounds of antibiotics within a short period of time can really increase your risk of developing anxiety or depression. In the American Journal of Gastroenterology, they discovered that if you have three rounds or more of antibiotics in a five-year period, you increase your risk of inflammatory bowel disease by 1.5 times. So, you know, Crohn's or colitis. Now, if you couple that on top of that with taking ibuprofen, paracetamol, having a couple of cans of beer, and living a quite an indiscriminate lifestyle, you seriously increase your risk of all kinds of different problems. You know, we're talking heart disease, diabetes, many different conditions can stem from antibiotics. Now, how the hell can that be? Well, it's because they're going to wipe out bacteria indiscriminately, good and bad, you know, the ugly and the beautiful. They just get this trash, they get destroyed. It's like the Marines coming into Iraq and just whatever, just bombing everything. Everything gets flattened. And unfortunately, we get collateral damage. I'm not saying the Marines are doing a bad job, they're following orders, but a lot of people that are innocent will get taken out. Whole cities get destroyed with innocent citizens in warfare. And it's the same in the gut. If we start throwing napalm around everywhere, well, we're going to damage a lot of stuff, you know. And sometimes it can take years or a lifetime to get that growth back again. So I'll often show a patient a picture of the Amazon forest and say, check this out. You can see trees. You can see bushes and shrubs. What you can't see are all the millions of insects crawling everywhere, all the tiny little spiders and all the tiny little bits of moss and lichen growing, the things you can't see. Now let's come along and do a bit of deforestation on a Sunday morning, you know, after church. We'll come in there and we'll just blow the whole lot away because we want to have a few hamburgers off the land. Now we come back in 5 years and what do we find? A couple of trees are growing back, but all those bugs and ants and moss, they'll likely never come back. And if they do, it could be 100 years. And not many people live 100 years. The point I'm making here is be very, very careful about antibiotics. I consider them probably one of the worst drugs ever created by humans for humans. This video hopefully will be watched in 100 years or 20 years or 50 years from now. And someone's going to say, man, that guy was right on, you know. I'm glad we stopped giving people that junk because we ruined so many lives. Out of all of the medications I've been involved with in all the years I've been a naturopath, I've not seen as much damage to people as I have with antibiotics. So take that as a warning, folks. Take that as a serious warning that you should not use them. A study was published recently in an American medical journal. I think it was through Harvard or Mayo, one of those clinics, that showed that over 60% of people, when they went to the doctor for a sore throat, they got an antibiotic prescription. Now, according to that medical journal, it should have been less than 10%. It's not the doctor's fault. The doctor's been taught that he or she should give that prescription. Okay, that's what they're taught. So they're just working according to what their education level is. But the patient should be more discerning and more careful and try and understand how damaging these drugs really can be. And there are other options, like gargling, for example, colloidal silver spray in the throat, gargling with, you know, maybe one drop of tea tree oil and a glass of tepid water. There are many, many ways you can overcome a sore throat by using a natural aid. You don't need to take drugs all the time for small things. Right? So the risk I see with antibiotics is far too great for the benefit for the majority of people. But I am not for one moment denying the fact that we need antibiotics. We need them as a top shelf for serious bacterial infections. But the amount of people that receive them for viral infections, it's crazy. How do you know if you've got a viral problem or a bacterial problem? Well, half the time you don't know that. but doctors generally will give, you know, in doubt, they will just give anyway. This is what I find with the majority of people who I see who say that the antibiotics work for a cold or a flu. They say, oh, well, I got so sick. I was producing green phlegm and mucus. I had a fever. I was really sick. So I went to the doctor and I got antibiotics because I needed them. And then not long after, 4 or 5 days later, I felt a lot better. Well, what likely happens, the person gets sicker. They get up to a high point, and that's when they go to the doctor, right? Instead of right at the onset, they go right when they're usually very sick. And at that point, their humoral immune response has kicked in anyway. Their lymphocytes have kicked in, their killer cells have kicked in, their memory cells, their helper cells, you know, their cytokine response. So everything there is already in motion by the body to overcome that infection, providing the person's intelligent enough to understand that Coke and fries and watching Netflix to 2 a.m. is probably not a good idea when you're sick. Providing the patient gets a lot of rest and sleep and cold drinks, maybe some chicken broth, we call it Jewish penicillin, you know. Providing the patient can take a bit of time off or have less stress in their life, 99.99.5% chance that they'll overcome that infection. Unless, of course, they're, you know, they're 85 with pneumonia in bed or something, that, you know, those are different scenarios. I'm talking the average person like you and me out there. So if you make allowances and allow the body to overcome that infection, you will likely not need an antibiotic. Look what grandma said, sweat it out, go to bed, you know, ride the fever. Let the fever get there high enough to kill that pathogen in the body. The body is supremely intelligent. A man is supremely stupid with drugs. So I just hope that this message gets through to a lot of people. So what we do know, we know that antibiotics create massive devastation and destruction in the body. But what we don't know with a lot of people is how the devastation can pan out for them in terms of eventually developing anxiety or depression, even weight gain. Studies have shown that antibiotics can really fatten people up, okay? Hog farmers love antibiotics because they'll tell you they can double the weight of a hog in a year just by giving antibiotics. We don't know why hogs, you know, or pigs or chickens or other animals get fattened up, but we do know it works. Now, if you're farming animals and you're getting paid per pound, you want to get as lot of pounds as possible, you know, out of that animal. So you're going to give a lot of antibiotics. And of course, when you eat that meat, you're getting that antibiotic. So make sure that you get antibiotic-free chicken. You get grass-fed antibiotic meat. If you're going to eat those kind of foods, you're probably not going to trash your gut as much. Take care, everybody. We'll catch up in the next video.